Enviro Close-Up is made possible in part by a grant from Greensphere.
Media and the Environment with Mark Crispin Miller next on Enviro Close-Up. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman. Our guest, Dr. Mark Crispin Miller. He's a professor of media ecology at New York University and executive director of the Project on Media Ownership at NYU. Welcome, Mark. The issue of media and what we say environment, I'm thinking mostly about environmental pollution, the mess that's all around us, and a lot of it produced by corporate environmental excess, the relationship.
Well, there's a very close and complex relationship between our severe environmental problems and the media system that we all inhabit. First of all, some of the major corporations that have a very large investment in the media per se are themselves big time corporate polluters. General Electric, for example, owns NBC and CNBC and half of MSNBC along with Microsoft. It's therefore not surprising that NBC, for example, doesn't do any kind of investigative reporting on nuclear power, doesn't do any kind of investigative reporting on the pollution of the Hudson River, doesn't do any kind of investigative reporting on defense electronics and that kind of thing, because GE is a major defense contractor. I could go on and on with things that NBC doesn't cover, nor do any of the other corporate news divisions cover these things, because these huge media corporations are not just competitors with one another, but in various ways they're also partners. We have what amounts to a kind of culture cartel, the mainstream media being owned by half a dozen transnational corporations with many, many interests. As I say, some of which, important ones, are themselves directly linked to the problems of pollution. But that's just one dimension of the situation that we're discussing. It isn't just because some of the major media firms are owned by parent companies that pollute that our media tends to contribute to the destruction of the planet. There's also, I think, the even more important fact that the media system that we live with in the United States is advertising driven. It's entirely commercial. In fact, by now it's hyper-commercial as deregulation has intensified over the last 20 years. The fact that it's the large corporate advertisers that basically determine what gets broadcast, that has everything to do with the plight that we're in today for two reasons. First of all, positively, there's the fact that what we actually see on TV hour after hour, night after night, week after week, is constant solicitations to consume recklessly and promiscuously, to buy all kinds of stuff that has destructive environmental consequences. That's, as it were, the positive effect. I don't mean good, I mean visible, noticeable. Meanwhile, there's a negative effect as well, one that we don't notice because it's negative, and that is that all kinds of pertinent coverage, news coverage, investigative reporting, simply doesn't get done. I mentioned the case of GE's various infractions and so on, stories that don't get told by NBC. But there's probably a limitless, an endless list of environmental stories that don't get told because to tell them would offend this or that trade group or individual corporate advertiser. Just one example, the Fox affiliate in Tampa, Florida, fired a couple of prize-winning investigative reporters who worked for the station, a married couple, because they had done a report on Monsanto, something of, you know, great moment to the viewers of that station, and therefore a story that would actually have helped that station serve the public interest. Well, Monsanto got in direct contact with Roger Ailes, who's in charge of Fox Television, and had him put pressure on the station in Tampa to get them to put pressure on this husband and wife investigative team to get them to redo this story so that they would basically be exonerating Monsanto. They wanted the story whitewashed. This couple spent a long, long time, you know, re-editing the story, rewriting it, coming up with, I think, dozens of different versions, none of which the station would accept. Finally, the couple were let go. They sued Fox. They had a kind of partial victory. But, you know, without our getting lost in the thicket of that particular case, the point that it makes is a crucially important one, that these corporate advertisers have tremendous clout. They have always had tremendous clout in the commercial media. Now that the media is so heavily consolidated and owned by parent companies that are themselves often big polluters, you see, the old problem is much worsened. So what we're basically watching is a nonstop commercial for lethal overconsumption with almost nothing in the way of a kind of journalistic corrective in the way of stories that would say, hey, you know, while you're busy buying these disposable diapers and plastic bottles and so on, this is what's happening, you know, with landfill, groundwater, you name it. Very, very little in the way of that kind of thing, despite the claims by a good many ill-informed and hysterical right-wingers who insist that there's a kind of liberal plot behind the media to bring us all sorts of unfounded environmental news. There's almost nothing, really, except for the occasional story on the problem of global warming. And I think even that is underreported.
A book like Bias by Bernard Goldberg, it's gotten a great deal of attention, and it's kind of the new Coulter book, too. A myth seems to me to be building about this liberal bias in media. I mean, like, where is that coming from, this claim, this allegation?
Well, the myth of the liberal bias in the media is not so much building as culminating, because it's really been gathering steam since the Nixon years. You know, Richard Nixon was convinced that there was a liberal plot to do him in. And actually something that contributed greatly to the myth was the U.S. loss of the war in Vietnam. I think most of the impetus behind this myth actually comes from the Pentagon, where a whole generation of officers are convinced that we lost the war, not because there were any military problems with our approach, but because we were stabbed in the back by a lot of peaceniks and liberals in the news media. The Army's own historian, William Hammond, disproved this long ago. But as you suggest by using the word myth, there's really no way in which rational argument can undercut this delusion, because it is a delusion. Now we have all kinds of media stars, Rush Limbaugh, Bill O'Reilly, Ann Coulter, Bernard Goldberg, whose book was reviewed all over the place, people who are all over the media claiming that right-wing voices never get a hearing in the media. Figure it out. It's demented, actually. And the books, too, that you mentioned, Slander by Ann Coulter, which I guess should be considered a how-to manual, and Bias by Bernard Goldberg are shockingly bad. I mean, they're books that are pervasively illogical. They do not succeed in making the case that they're trying to make. Anyone who claims that there's a liberal bias in the media has to account for the almost total lack of labor reporting by the mainstream media machine, the almost total exclusion of any voices or faces to the left of the Democratic Party, has to contend with the fact that we lived through 8 years of media persecution of Bill Clinton over a whole range of things that had no basis in fact, from Whitewater and Troopergate and Filegate to the rest of it. Whereas George W. Bush, whose transgressions are actual and the consequences of which are momentous, has gotten a free ride. I could sit here for hours, Carl, and give you examples. of the absolute lack of anything even remotely resembling a liberal bias in the media. But it is a myth, and it is the consequence of a long and fervent propaganda drive, and the kinds of beliefs that people develop because of propaganda drives, like the fact that the Soviet Union wanted to rule the world. You know, you can invoke contrary evidence in a rational spirit all you want. There will always be those who can't and won't see the truth because they're invested in that call to arms.
On the matter of media, like, what do we do about it? I mean, it seems to me to be worsening and worsening, this situation, the monopolization that you speak of has become, I mean, six companies dominating media in the United States and, in fact, increasingly globally.
Well, this is a problem that is not anomalous because, as we know, this kind of consolidation is going forward in every sector of the economy, really throughout the world. There are also just a handful of corporations that dominate the media in Europe. They aren't the same ones as those that dominate our media. But it is simply the media-related aspect of a problem that's absolutely pervasive throughout the economy. I think that the concentration of ownership in the media, however, is a far worse problem than it is in any other sector of the economy, because we learn all that we know about the world, basically, from the media. If it is following its own agenda, if it's trying to do little more than improve the bottom line, if it is getting ever closer to the government in an effort to feather its own nest, we got a very, very serious problem, because we can't really have a functioning democracy if the media system is itself a fount of misinformation and propaganda, whether it's commercial or political propaganda. What do we do about it? Well, I think that we need, desperately need, an actual political movement to carry out a number of quite sweeping reforms, including rigorous antitrust measures to break these commercial players down to size, serious re-regulation of the broadcast media, whose owners now derive obscene profits from using the public airwaves, which belong to us. They pay nothing in return for the privilege of using them, and in the climate of deregulation, they are under no obligation, really, to compensate us through any kind of alternative programming. This is basically the legacy of the Reagan through Clinton and Bush years. There's been too little difference between the major political parties on this issue. So we need antitrust measures. We need re-regulation. Those steps would help us to make the commercial media sphere a little more competitive again, which I think would be a good thing. At the same time, we need, in this country, we really do need an authentically public broadcasting system, not like what we have now with NPR and PBS, which are increasingly hard to tell apart from ABC and CBS. We need something a little bit closer to the model of the BBC or the CBC in Canada, a well-funded, genuinely independent public broadcast system that is local as well as national, by the way, that stands alone, that doesn't have to fear the wrath of conservative congressmen or corporate advertisers. And then finally, we have to find ways to facilitate democratic participation in media policy. I mean, right now you talk to most people about media policy, their eyes understandably glaze over because it's an entirely federal issue, and it tends too often to be highly technical and legalistic. I myself find it excruciatingly boring, you know. People, therefore, at the state and municipal levels don't have any sense of how to participate, and they should be allowed to do so. I think media is far too important to be left to what is laughably referred to as the market these days. There should be a cabinet-level position concerning media policy. We should follow the lead of other countries, New Zealand, Sweden, and others, that where at least the Democratic parties actually have fully articulated media positions. You know, we don't have anything like that. And it has everything to do with the excessive power of the media in our political system, which in turn relates to the fact that most campaigning is now done through the media. So let me put this very simply. Those who are concerned about campaign finance reform, which is a crucial issue, ought to come to see that that issue is as it were, joined at the hip with media reform. The two have to basically be pursued in tandem. You know, all the money that gets spent on political advertising goes to the media. This is why the National Association of Broadcasters is one of the top lobbyists against campaign finance reform, which is something most people don't know. And of course, they don't know it because the media won't report it. You know, not a big mystery there. Anyway, this is an issue that first of all has to be recognized as an issue. See, if we're going to get anything accomplished, it's not even really recognized as an issue by most Democrats. It's not recognized as an issue by the large non-right-wing foundations in this country, which have been extremely dense on the subject of media. You know, having banged my head against that wall for years, I know what I'm talking about. So, I'm here like John the Baptist crying in the wilderness with a few other people like Bob McChesney to try to get people to wake up to the need for something to be done as soon as possible.
The right wing knows the importance of media and has been involved in attempting to manipulate media and to load right wing trained journalists into media. But the so-called progressive community doesn't seem to get it.
No, they don't get it at all. They don't understand. And interestingly, I can't exactly explain how this relates to the point you're making, but it does relate. The only organized political interest in this country that has a view of the media as a problem is the right wing. You know, they're concerned about sex and violence. And their approach is completely censorious and paranoid. They think the media is in the hands of all kinds of 60s holdovers, homosexuals and Jews and so on. That it's kind of a cabal by these un-American types to force bad values on the rest of the country. That's demented, and it takes no account whatsoever of the economic thrust of the media itself, because right-wingers can't really do critiques of capitalism run amok. Nevertheless, you know, although it's ill-considered and mistaken, it at least does begin to address something that is a real problem. The content of the media is increasingly degraded, increasingly idiotic. Now, the way it will affect people in the Bible Belt is different from the way it will affect you and me. You know, we're concerned about the whiting out of certain kinds of news stories and so on. We're concerned about the rise of idiotic programming. They're concerned about the rise of, you know, too much TNA and so on. Well, there's a difference, but there's also a community of interests. And I think that a lot of people who regard themselves as conservatives could be made to see that what distresses them about the media is not the result of a few un-American types being involved in the media machine. It's the result of the relentless drive for profits. The point being that progressives have got to begin to articulate a different explanation for what's wrong with the media, and that demands that we admit something is wrong with the media. Progressives are often reluctant to get into this territory because it's not cool to say, look, there's a lot of trash on television. You know, there's a lot of idiocy. There's a lot of stuff that you wouldn't want your kids to watch, you know. Progressives with children can understand this more readily than progressives without, I think. But we oughtn't to cede that whole ground to the right wing, because they treat the issue demagogically and invidiously, you see. And finally, ineffectually, because they wouldn't ever interfere with Rupert Murdoch, for example. Whereas, you know, progressives can and should interfere with him and all the rest of them.
Mark, your most recent book is The Bush Dyslexicon. What makes our president dyslexic?
Well, the Bush Dyslexicon is an analysis of both Bush and the mainstream media, an analysis carried out through a close examination of Bush's infamously fractured language. It's a funny title. There are a lot of laughs in the book, but I want your viewers to understand that it's not just an exercise in derision. It's not just a funny book. There are such books out there. This is not one of them. This is a very serious political analysis. It attempts to explain how we got to the present situation in which a patently unfit and completely anti-democratic president is in power despite the fact that he lost both the popular and electoral votes. The mainstream media is fine with this. After spending 8 years assailing Clinton for all sorts of things that he didn't even do, here we have an authentic junta running the country for the sake of their friends, dangerously short-sighted and completely incompetent, whose programs are vastly unpopular, even with many people who believe they personally like the president. And the media treats them with kid gloves. This is remarkable to me. It's extraordinary. And the Bush Dyslexicon is an attempt to help us understand this. And it also sheds a lot of light on the man in the Oval Office. One of the things I discovered, and I think makes the book, if I do say so myself, very valuable, is an important distinction between those moments when Bush is indeed incoherent, often laughably so, and many other moments when he's quite lucid. The tendency just to laugh Bush off because he fractures the language tends to blind us, I think, to the reality of the situation. Bush is not a moron. He's severely limited intellectually. There's no question about that. He can't really reason on any kind of a high level. And he doesn't know anything. He's probably the most ignorant chief executive we've ever had, easily, I would say. But when it comes to a kind of political cunning, maybe you could compare it to the intelligence of a good poker player. I think he's quite sharp. I think he's far more intelligent than somebody like Dan Quayle, who also, you know, was well known for screwing up the language, but who I think was and is genuinely dumb, you know. Whereas Bush isn't, really. And one indication of this is the fact that it's only when Bush tries to feign compassion or altruism or idealism, it's only then that he really starts to speak gibberish. But when he talks about certain other subjects, that is to say, when he talks from the heart, there's nothing wrong with his language. This is true of all of us. We're most eloquent when we're speaking from the heart. Bush is no exception. He's a very bad liar. So when he tries to feign concern for the disadvantaged, that's when he screws up. My favorite example from last year when the book first came out was his famous statement when campaigning in New Hampshire. He said, "I know how hard it is for you to put food on your family," which was a good one. And you know, the press made much of it, but nobody noticed that it was a statement that he couldn't really make because it involved expressing a feeling he doesn't have. The fact is, he doesn't know how hard it is for people to put food on their family table. See, it's not a hard thing to say. He doesn't know what it's like and he doesn't care. His whole biography is just a study in upper class callousness of the worst kind. Now, what's out today is a new edition. It just came out a few weeks ago. It's a paperback. It's got a lot of new material. When he talks about the death penalty, when he talks about baseball, when he talks about hardball politics, when he talks about his land in Texas, interestingly, his ranch, he's perfectly clear. And in fact, when talking about his ranch, he's almost poetic. And it's completely off the cuff. He loves his spread. It's his.
This land is my land, you know. He loves the game of baseball. He loves putting men to death. I think he's a sadist, frankly. So that when he talks about these things, or when he's cracking nasty jokes or putting people down, no problem with his language at all. And I think that's very, very telling.
Environmental issues are elements in the Bush dyslexicon?
Oh, yeah. There's a whole important chapter in the book on Bush's attempts to talk about the environment. And there again, when he tries to feign a sort of Teddy Rooseveltian conservation-mindedness, the results are comic. He can't do it. And there's a lot of material in the book and references to other books that people should read that deals with Bush's very, very dangerous attitude towards the environment, really an extremist attitude toward the environment. People will probably remember Dick Cheney's manly sneer at conservation. It might be okay as a sign of personal virtue, but it's no basis for a policy. Well, this is absolutely typical of the whole cabal around Bush. This is not just a personal quirk of his. He represents oil interests that are interested only in raping the earth as thoroughly as possible to extract maximum profits, to keep our dangerous dependency on fossil fuels alive, just the way that a pusher wants to keep addicts on the drugs that he sells. There's really no difference at all. Now, any attempt by journalists to get at this truth during the campaign was blocked by the campaign's enforcers. And I describe in the Bush dyslexicon what Gail Sheehy went through, for example, when she was doing her profile of Bush for Vanity Fair, which we all have heard of primarily because in it she proposes the argument that he is dyslexic. But none of the coverage of Gail Sheehy's story talks about what's even more important by far than that, and that is that when she started to look into the pollution in Odessa and other places in Texas populated by the poor, when she saw how utterly grotesque, hellish life had become for these people because of dense downpours of all kinds of toxic waste, she was blocked by the campaign whose people told her the governor will not be participating in your profile. And it was Kremlin stuff, you know. Which is not a far-fetched analogy, because I really think that the Republicans now, the Bush people, are quite like Bolsheviks. You know, they will do whatever they need to do. They will lie as much as they need to lie. They will resort to anything they need to resort to in order to maintain their grip on power. I think they're utterly amoral and quite dangerous for many reasons, a major one of which is the effect on the environment of the world.
And not surprisingly, the corporate media is not calling the administration up on the environmental issues.
No, I mean, if things get appreciably worse even than they are now with this regime, and if we live through it and recover somewhat, you know, the historians of the future will be quite damning in their assessment of the media and the job it's done in covering this team. It's really remarkable how little the American people are told about what goes on with these people in charge. I mean, anyone who's interested should just go online and read the coverage of the United States in foreign newspapers like The Guardian in Britain or like The Times of India and so on. You could get something like an accurate view of what's really happening here.
Media and the Environment with Mark Crispin Miller. Thank you so much. Thank you for watching Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman. To get a copy of the Bush Dyslexicon, Amazon.com, or perhaps your independent bookseller. It's published by Norton. And for information about this and other Enviro video programs, just go to www.envirovideo.com. Thank you.